Hello everyone, welcome to Abhipedia, powered by Abhimanyu IS. This is 19th lecture of Science and Tech Value Addition Series with Dr. Vivek Rana. I'll be covering themes and topics which are important from UPSC Prelims 2020 point of view. And topic for today's lecture is once again an interdisciplinary one. There are two topics which you should be familiar or brush up with before going through this topic detail. Biotechnology and robotics. Like in one of the last lectures, we had covered Vyom Mitra, which was example of space as well as artificial intelligence. Today's topic would involve your knowledge, will test your knowledge about biotech as well as robotics. So this peculiar term xenobot is making headlines in the last week of January. So I'll be decoding what a xenobot is, what are the technical details, what could be the potential applications of this xenobot, and additional topics which can be revised in case the UPSC decides to frame an out-of-box question, and eventually a practice question to brush your facts. So let's start today's lecture on xenobot. Now, first of all, what all you should know about xenobot should be on your tips is like, what is the organizations which have developed this bot, what are the potential applications for which this technology can be used in future, are there any concerns or ethical dilemmas which are stopping us from realizing the full potential of this technology, and what are the associated topics which can be revised. So first of all, what is this acronym? Because X, Xeno word you generally don't come across when you are going through any of the text. So this xenobot is derived from term Xenopus, because this xenobot is nothing but is being touted as a living robot. More specifically, it has been described as one of the first programmed living organisms. So it's not a living organism, not a total mechanical bot. It is something in between, because it's making use of living cells which have been derived from African clawed frog. And African clawed frog scientific name is Xenopus levis. So they have borrowed that term xeno from that African toad. Okay, so distribution of that frog is widespread. It's found from Nigeria to Somalia to South Africa, because associated one of the statements could be on African toad also. So make sure you are familiar with this. So African clawed frog, Xenopus, is what this nomenclature is based on. Bot is for the robot. Now, what are the organizations behind this new discovery? So, US scientists have researched on this topic. Michael Levin is the person who has been attributed for spearheading this project. And there are two universities to be specific. There is University of Vermont and there is Tufts University, which has contributed to this groundbreaking research. Even though specific universities might not be asked, but at least you should know the nation that it's the US breakthrough which is making the headlines. Now, coming to the tools and technologies used, because this is quite a complex thing which has been created, and they two disciplines have come together, biotech as well as the computing one. So supercomputers using evolutionary algorithms have been used to modify stem cells in the desired direction. To give you a brief overlook, like the diagram which you were seeing is involving some combination of cells and some supercomputing image is being superimposed to make you understand that. Just let's go back to the diagram. You can see the image on the left side which you are seeing is of supercomputer algorithm based. The second one is the xenobot itself, the living cell, which is moving in particular direction. So basically, they first of all, scientists isolated embryo cells from that frog species, clawed frog Xenopus. And since they were embryonic stem cells, they were undifferentiated state, meaning they are not capable of performing any specific functions. They were programmed into two different types of cell. The upper cells were of the skeletal cells, which are rigid in nature, they are not contractile. And the second type of cells were modified into heart cells. Heart cells, we know, are contractile in nature. They can move. So they then use the complex algorithms of supercomputers to create this Xenobot so that the upper part remains stable and the lower part could move in the desired direction. It's your discretion. You can make it move in a straight line. You could make it go in, around in a circle, whatnot. So in wedge and arc form, they were created using these complex algorithms. And so that's why they have been compared to a living machine or a living bot. So this is, so basically the stem cell have been used from embryonic stage, and heart and the skeletal cells are the ones which have been combined and they are being made use of. So what could be the likely applications of such scenario? Because the size of these cells is just 1 mm wide. So basically they can enter any living structure like some artery or some other tissue, and they could perform the desired function when needed. So currently the scientists have predicted that this technology can be used to deliver the stem cells itself or some drugs at the specific localized site. Even outside the body, they can be used in microplastic campaign. You can see the bead plastic campaign is gaining momentum, and microplastics or microbeads are creating havoc with the environment. So such living cells can be programmed to tackle the menace of microplastic, and even in radioactive ways, some have suggested that they can be used in some sort of way. Other than that, some new groundbreaking healthcare treatments can be designed because they are capable of entering, like the one we discussed in our class lecture as well. At times, there's a clogging or some plaques get deposited in artery and we have to unblock it. So such living bots can be made to enter that site and they can clear that site because they are capable of movement in the desired direction. And they can, if some clock is blocking, they can move it or can dissolve it, depending upon it. So molecular machines, which were once awarded Nobel Prize, they are taking that theme to the next level by creating the living machines. Since they are made of living cell, biological acceptance or immunological reaction is going to be further minimized. So this technology or discovery is likely to contribute to more research, and eventually the full potential is can be made in the healthcare sector in a major way. Now coming to, like all technologies, there is some negative side as well, and concerns all have already been highlighted in some of the section. So some critics are saying that we are just messing things up further by creating living bots. Already the humanoids and that theme is plaguing some of the minds. So some section is saying that it's not the right way to go about the things by creating life without its consent and then trying to modify it. These living cells have survived for 7 to 10 days, and automatically then and they're capable of surviving by using the all existing energy from the body. So there are concerns that what if these different types of these xenobots combine together to form a living structure, and there's the, or they might not, they might get rouge or do not follow them. So basically the living part makes them a little complex to understand. Also some ethical concerns are there that human beings are playing God or are acting against the nature by creating life forms, and this is a clear-cut example then on which we are creating life as per our requirement. So these ethical dilemmas are likely to persist for some time, but eventually once the technology gets accepted, such things get sidelined, because at one time embryonic stem cell debate is still going on because embryo gets destroyed in the process, but there are proponents who are using it and working on induced pluripotent stem cells to end that debate. In similar way, some middle ground would be eventually come out and these things would get accepted in near future. So mainly we have to work and draw the line for what purposes this technology should be ideally used, because the other side also says that what if these bots are made to enter inside someone's body on intention and produce some negative ill effects. Kind of biological warfare can be designed on such means, and some harmful pathogens can be made to enter and or can be used to just made any person dysfunction or may function as per the requirement of some scientific objective. So there are some ethical dilemmas which need to be addressed. Some broad guidelines or regulations should be out on this theme. But still, once let us realize first the potential of this technology and then try to regulate it. Because over-regulation at times kill the research at the nascent stage. So we should first try to balance the pros and cons and then move forward. So this is what Xenobot is. Now let's discuss some associated topics which you should revise when you are going through this topic. Now you could see the first topic which ideally to be revised is stem cells, because you can see this journey of the Xenobot has started from isolating embryonic stem cells from that Xenopus. So we should go through what stem cells are. They are biological cells derived from multicellular organisms which are capable of self-renewal and multiplying themselves, and can be have high potency to differentiate into specialized stem cells. Embryonic, fetal, adult stem cell, the ethical debate you should go through, their potential applications, because stem cell question has already been asked in UPSC mains once. So there's highly probable even in prelims they can just ask about the basic properties, their property of self-renewal, potency and undifferentiated state. Then the second theme, since computing algorithms, evolutionary algorithms from supercomputers were used to get the right combination of that cells, so you should go through the application of various supercomputers, how supercomputers revolutionize weather predictions, climate models, space research, defense research, nuclear research, and all physical simulations of various scientific endeavors. And also just give a quick reading to the top supercomputers which are functioning, operating at the world stage. There is a US Summit, then there is Yahoo Lite, IBM Sierra. So you should be familiar with it. In India, it's the Pratyush. And eventually some robotics which have been dominating headlines because a match the following or incorrectly paired theme can be asked. Like in last lecture we had covered Vyom Mitra. There is a chaser from European Union which is will be used to collect the space debris. And then we have our own Bandicoot which is being used in manual scavenging. So make sure all the humanoids or some bots which have made headlines are revised as well. Now finally let's do a practice question, and once again it's just a revision of the factual information about the robots, and you have to pick the correctly matched pair out of the following. So the first combination we have just discussed, Xenobot, is a living robot. It can be picked. Yes, the right term should be the programmed living organism or the programmed living bot. These all are acceptable, living bot. So make sure you remain flexible because it's general studies. So living machines, living bots, all are acceptable in case of Xenobot. Then the ROS is an interesting one. It's the world's first artificial intelligent lawyer, because in this week, even India have also started working on such projects to use expert systems, which are artificial intelligence based, to help them in legal assistant research, so that decision making in judgments can be made faster and we could make the best use of technology, because it's high time we just adopt technologies in the right spirit and make the best use of it. And then the Vyom Mitra, we all know, is the space bot, and it's the half humanoid robot developed by ISRO for the Gaganyaan mission. So we had a full lecture on it, so by now you all must be familiar. So D option is the right one, all of the above. Make sure whenever some easy question appears, you never jump, because at times you might someone who has not read the full question might have attempted A option or a B option if you had half information. So even in easier question, make sure you are going through the D option so that you pick the right combination. So this is what I have for today's lecture. I hope this lecture was useful, and I'll be back soon with another science and tech value addition lecture which will be dominating headlines. Keep preparing. All the best.